Without those individuals, okay.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks for waiting. We're going to take roll call so that we can begin the meeting.
Honorable Eric Adams, Candice Julian, Office of Brooklyn Borough President.
Present.
Honorable Jeffrey Aubrey, excuse. Jacqueline Bailey, excuse. Gloria Benfield, present. Honorable Gail Brule, Jessica Mace, excuse. Monty Castaneda, from Region 17, Queens, NDA 347. Honorable Bill de Blasio, Ellen Powell Miller, Marco Carrion, Jacqueline De Leon, excuse. Melissa Del Valle Ortiz.
Presente.
Honorable Ruben Diaz Jr., Monica Major, excuse. Thomas Dow, excuse. Honorable Eugene Matthew, David Suarez, Vanessa Oga, Honorable Jalissa Ferraris, Helen Hines Foreman, Tessa Hackett Varia, excuse. Helene Hartman Karnowski. Honorable Letitia James, Barbara Sherman.
Present.
Rita Jones, excuse. Honorable Melinda Katz, Susie Tannenbaum. Honorable Andy King, Aisha Hernandez, excuse.
It's another person.
It's a gentleman.
Michael Armstrong, he's excused.
Honorable Melissa Mafarito, Jessica Ackerman.
Present.
Our chair from Modell Sporting Goods, Gregory Hammond.
Here.
Morris Heights Health Center, Gillian Duncan. Duffley, excuse. Municipal Credit Union, Joseph Galliardo, excuse. Neighborhood Housing Services of Staten Island, First Vice Chair, Joseph Pierre, excuse. Honorable James Otto, Vache Young.
Present.
Vasha Mati Patel. Honorable Bill Perkins, Todd Barron, Tamika Robinson, excuse. Christian Rodriguez. Honorable Deborah Rose, Edwina Mott.
Present.
Dahlia Soto.
Present.
Honorable Scott Stringer, Marilyn Mosley. St. Francis College, Robert Oliver. Is St. Francis College?
Ruben Gonzalez.
And he's excused?
I don't know.
Maria Tavarius. UJA Federation of Jewish Philanthropy, New York City. Shasha Kessler, or Hillary Stucking?
Excuse.
United Neighborhood Houses, Andrea Bowman, excuse. UPS, Laura James, Karen Francis.
No,
Present. I'm Janet DeLucas. I'm teaching Karen's place from now on. And
your name is what?
Janet DeLucas, DLUGOSZ.
And we'll recognize the change at the meeting. Thank you. We have the letter.
Peter Weiss, parliamentarian, excused. Vera Williams.
Here.
Bernice Williams Johnson.
Yes.
Dave Agetz. David Alexander. Ruben Gonzalez. Linda Walter.
Here she is.
And Helene just walked.
And Helen.
Helene just came in.
Okay, thank you everyone. Although it looks like a small group, we do have a quorum, so I want to welcome everyone to the board meeting. We'll hopefully can get through the topics pretty swiftly so everyone can get home. Let's just start off with the acceptance of the minutes from our last meeting. And just a reminder, as I always do, I believe we have an extra mic, but if not, if you speak, please just state your name for the record. We'll pass the mic around as well for the stenographer. So as far as the minutes from the last meeting, hopefully everyone has had an opportunity to review that. And if so, if there aren't any questions or concerns regarding those minutes, I will now entertain a motion to accept the minutes from our previous meeting.
So moved.
Please just state your name.
Bernice Williams. Hello.
And is there properly seconded by Vera Williams? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, abstaining, there being none, so moved. Thank you for that.
I'm going to abstain.
Okay, so all right, so we have one abstention, Marilyn Mosey. Okay, so next, in terms of board correspondence, we have a few new CAB members we need to recognize. And then a few we need to reconfirm. We've kind of been through this process before, so for the purpose of the records, we just need to continue to do this. Okay, so then we got to take care of this letter here, right? Okay. All right, so the members.
I'm almost gone.
So the members have to be present to be recognized. So we're going to pass on recognizing those new CAB members. First, the members that we need to reconfirm. So from the Office of the Mayor, we have Howard Miller. Is he here? So they don't have to be present to reconfirm. All right, so let me backtrack so all the CAB members are aware. So that they know what we're voting for. These are members we need to reconfirm that is required by the state for their records. We've done this at previous meetings. So we have Harold Miller, who's from the Office of the Mayor, from the Office of Staten Island Borough President, Lachey Young, and we have Sasha Kessler from UJA. So that is three members. They were all here present at the last meeting. So Harold Miller, Lachey Young, Sasha Kessler. So I want to entertain a motion just to reconfirm their commitment to the board for the matter of the records for the state. I'll entertain a motion now.
So moved.
Very properly moved.
Johnson.
Thank you.
Second.
I said it first.
Okay, state
your name. Melissa,
I'm going to start. All right, to a properly second, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, abstaining, there being none, so moved.
Thank you.
cutting that meeting on the 20th.
So next, as it was stated, we do have a new appointment to the CAB, so let me read the letter as a representative from the UPS. Dear Mr. Hambrick, on behalf of the UPS, I would like to express our interest in joining the New York City Community Action Board. UPS is a global logistics leader with more than 400,000 employees. Our company spans 108 years, and what we do every day impacts the community and the world. To us, this means more than just writing a check. It means combining employee skill, passion, and time with our logistics expertise, transportation assets, and charitable donations to make a measurable difference in society today. I believe that Laura James, East Regional Community Relations Manager for UPS, will make an excellent representative on the CAB. Laura oversees all of UPS community service efforts east of the Mississippi River. She is a native New Yorker, committed to seeing her city develop and prosper. And as an alternate representative, Janet
DeLucas.
How do you pronounce that?
DeLucas.
DeLucas, all right. It's pronounced much different than it's spelled. Thank you. A segment and marketing manager, she would make a terrific addition to the CAB. So if you have any questions on Laura, Janet, please feel free to contact me. Sincerely, James Banner, who is the VP of Marketing for the UPS East Region. Join me in welcoming Laura James as the new representative from the UPS on the CAB.
Oh, that's nice.
It was representative, so she comes in.
The main and I'm the alternate.
And she's alternate, right. Any words that you want to say to address the CAB?
Well, I'm very excited to be here and looking forward to working with you all and working with Laura. I've been with UPS about 14 years. I do live in Midtown, so I'm excited to be here.
Great. Well, we welcome you and thank you for coming. All right, so next up, when we get to the operations section of the agenda, you know that we do have to vote in a new third vice chairperson. Karen Eason, who formerly filled that position as part of the executive board, is taking in a new role with DYCD, and as a result, she has to resign from the board. So she's here today officially as part of her last meeting, so we wanted to first thank her, and I wanted to, on behalf of the executive board and the CAB, first thank her for her service to the CAB. I want to congratulate her in her new role with DYCD. And Karen, come up. I want to wish you all the best of luck.
I'm getting my severance pay.
Saddened that I can no longer participate in the manner I'm used to. I'm going to miss being a part of the board.
You're still coming to the meeting, though.
You see, I'm still here. But I just wanted to say thank you all for the time that I was able to serve. And I know that going forward, it seems like this position, everybody ends up graduating to a new level. That's what happened to the last person. So whoever gets the next position, good luck for them. Thanks, Greg.
When did you start?
I started September 19th. And I came off of open competitive list, exam list.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so wonderful. It was just happened that DYCD called me first.
Wow. Congratulations.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you. That's wonderful.
So I think since we took the attendance, Helen Foreman Hines. Anyone else came in since we?
Monty Castaneda came in.
And Susan
Tenenbaum.
Okay, great. Just want to get it for the record.
Yes.
Thank you. All right, next up, we're going to ask ours to come up and give us our financial recap.
Jill was
going to
stay with
us.
She's not going to be. Oh, no.
I'm not sure your mic is on.
Yes, hi. My name is Artis Antmoven. I work in the budget office, and I'm going to present a very brief financial report tonight. You've seen this image before from the very first meeting we had this fiscal year. The budget information remains the same. We have program contracts at $28 million. We have other contractual services as just over $2 million and personal services at $4.7 million. This information I'm presenting is as of October 2016. We provided this report to our program folks early because of multiple holidays that we had this month. And we wanted to make sure you got this with enough time to review it. So because of that, we don't have any October information here. It's true September. So we ran the information in October, but really our October's data is only now coming in. So there's no October data in this presentation. Because of that, we have lower spending than we would have had if we had a month more data here.
That's what it's
been. Okay, so the good news is that overall spending is at 23%. We should be at 25%, so I'd say we're on track. The bad news is that most of that spending right now is in our SYP portfolio. SYP has spent 77% of its portfolio, so it's making up for the underspending in the other areas. For the neighborhood development group, we're at 12%. For the immigration refugee assistance, we're at 16%. Fatherhood, which is usually one of our very robust spenders, is currently at 8%. And the reason for that is we have amended their contracts for this fiscal year. So they're right now in a new contract year, and registration is taking a little longer than we anticipated. Adolescent literacy is at 7%, and that's mostly due to the fact that for literacy programs, it really starts to ramp up in September. There's not that much going on in July and August because it's the summer, and spending really ramps up in September and later. So based on all of that, we were at 23%, and I said before we should be at 25. For payments, year to date, we have paid out 34%. And for those who are maybe new, our payments are higher than our expenses because we give our providers an advance in starting the fiscal year. So when they're starting up and they're ramping up, they don't have expenses to give to us, but they still need money to start their programs. So the BYCD policy is to give 2 months of their entire contract in advance. So if we were to compare this spending rate to the last meeting, there's been a 31% increase from the last meeting to this meeting. So we were at $4.5 million in expenditures, and we're currently at around $6.5. That's about $2 million, and that represents a 31% increase from the last meeting. Similarly, on the payments side, it's about at 32%. We were at $6.6 million. We're at now $9.6. That's a $3 million difference, and that represents about a 32% increase from the last meeting. At the last meeting, somebody had asked us about our SYP numbers. And before I ask for questions, I just want people to know that we served 60,113 parking spaces this past summer, which is our highest ever. I'm so sorry. I'm saying that at the last meeting, there were a few inquiries about how many participants were served in our SYP program, where CSBG provides some of that funding. The total number of participants was 60,113 young people, and it's our highest number yet. So that is
for the coming summer?
The summer had just ended. So the beauty about SYP is that it starts right as the city fiscal year starts. And it basically ends 3 months into the fiscal year. So that's my presentation. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions on the financial report at all?
It starts just after the 4th of July, and it runs for 6 weeks. So around the middle of August is when the participants stop working. But we are still taking about the next 4 weeks to finish paying our participants for supplemental payrolls and so on. So by the end of September, we fully paid all our participants, but our providers keep sending us invoices. So for example, even though the program has ended, we've paid 77% of the program, but we'll still continue to pay our providers over the next few months, and that'll come up to about 98 to 100% of the program.
Any other questions?
Sure.
Yes.
What's
just
the,
state your name,
the
please.
End of the process for the providers to get in their invoices?
It's a very good question. We allow our providers to claim over the entire city fiscal year. So we don't, and this is something that they prefer, they don't want to claim for the program only during the months that it's being run. So they don't want to claim for over 3 months. They prefer to submit their expenses over the entire city fiscal year.
That was Helen Foreman.
Yes, Jessica.
Hi, my name is Jessica Ackerman. So out of the total amount of funding that's spent on FYEP, what does the money from CSBG funds cover?
So we've this year CSBG contributed $5.6 million, and I think that's about 3,800 participants.
Mm-hmm. So does it support particular participants?
Yes,
or, okay.
Particular participants, correct.
What kinds of participants would fall under that category?
Maybe you can speak more to this, but we have to meet our CSBG eligibility requirements, and I know that my colleague.
Just very briefly, as you may know, and members of the board may know, there's various different funding streams that go into summer youth employment program, so we're able to scale up the program each year based on what the different funding streams allow. So it actually isn't a hardship for the CBOs when they're able to receive more or lesser amounts of CSBG to target those slots to youth and families that meet the federal poverty criteria. And I know there are some set-asides, like younger members of SYP and some set-asides for vulnerable populations. We'll get back to you to confirm this, but I don't think CSBG goes to those special populations.
It does not. It goes to the general population that meets those criteria.
Well,
thanks.
Any other questions? Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
So if there aren't any other questions, I'll entertain a motion now to accept the quarterly financial report. So probably move by Marilyn Mosley.
Second.
Vera Williams. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, abstaining, there being none, so moved. Thank you. Next up, we're going to have our commissioner's report.
¿Cómo está todo el mundo? How's everybody doing?
Good, how you doing?
Everybody's good?
Good.
Happy Thanksgiving. Oh my God, it's time to eat. This is my favorite time of the year. I want to be thankful, but I gotta admit, this is my favorite time. So, I have a lot. We have a lot to report tonight. We got like three big things to report. Is this working?
Yes.
Okay. So there's three major things we want to report this evening, and I'm going to report on the initiatives that you've probably heard some of, but I'll give you some details on those. And then Joe is going to talk about where we are on the needs assessment and the public hearing. And Mike is going to do the main presentation, which is your update on the report on the program performance report. And part of it was that Artis gave to you, and he's going to give you the report for the year 2016. And this doing this fulfills one of the standards 6.5 on the annual state review. Remember that across report that I told you about a couple of meetings ago, that we had met some of the standards but not others? Well, this meets one of them. Since the last meeting, we fulfilled 8 out of the 17 that we hadn't completed, and that only leaves 9 to complete before April. So we're doing good. Don't you think?
Mm-hmm.
Well, come on, stay with me now. Okay. So next year, we're going to have even a more rigorous report. So it'll be, we did the across, and then this next one, that which is due in April, is going to be, it's called the tracks. And it's even more rigorous, and it'll ask for more information. So we're already working on that. Okay. The last time we met, I gave you a lot of detail about the strategic plan, and you saw how excited I was, right? Mm-hmm. And our strategic plan really describes the goals that we have going forward with not just CSBG funding, but the entire agency and how we plan to combine our efforts to fight poverty in our city. The 2016 strategic plan was submitted to the state, and it was accepted by you. Since then, we've begun to take elements of the strategic plan, and we really started to work on those. We also started to work on some of the settlement house goals. Now, you might remember that maybe last spring, Denise Williams came and she did a presentation on the settlement house recommendations. And basically, that was just a framework to put community back in the middle of what DYCD does with the entire agency. So what it allowed us to do is make the goal not these siloed kind of goals about youth and the community separately and seniors separately, but that to look at everybody that lives in a community has a part in developing. And that's the reason why we did the recommendations. One of the settlement house goals was to bring together community, not just the workers of that community, but the agencies of that community, the residents of that community, and everybody who has a stake in that community. And the reason for that is that we believe that these communities are assets. They're just not people we fund. They have assets even though there are issues in those communities that need development or they deal with poverty issues. So we did something on a Saturday, and it was called Connect the Dots, and this was in Brownsville. And so do you know how many people came to that thing? Does anyone know? It was a lot of people there. It was a Saturday morning. It was that first Saturday morning. It was really cold.
Well, and it rained, but everybody converged in Brownsville, and they actually had a lot of interaction back and forth. City agencies, the different DYCD program units, and the residents. And they talked about how might they do their work better, how could they receive the services, and all that good stuff. So it was a very successful event. We've done these kind of community things before in CD, and we will continue to do them as part of our strategic plan, but we're going to see how they, we're actually going to start looking at how they impact the community, and whether or not they do. I doubt that they won't, but we'll see how. The last thing is that around goals and the strategic plans is that we have another major effort underway to fulfill of the state and city's twin goals of advancing the work of minority and women-owned businesses and enterprises, known as MWBE. This effort is particular because in regards to SBG funding, that's the money that we receive from the state. Currently, there's a number of approaches that we are employing to fulfill MWBE goals. In fact, we already have begun to demonstrate our commitment to this goal by focusing on using eligible vendors for budget categories covered by the MWBE guidelines. This past Monday, we had two sessions where we brought together the providers, and we had several presentations. Also, there was a webcam by the state where they were able to ask, we made some presentations, they asked a lot of questions about how to get to the percentages that each one of those providers needs to get to in order to fulfill what we have to do with the state. Another part of the strategic plan is to focus on the needs assessment, which we'll be discussing for a few minutes. But you've seen the surveys out there, and we've collected a lot. Joe's going to tell you how many we've collected, and he's also going to talk with you about the public hearings and how that is going. But before we do that, I wanted to say that you guys are amazing. And it's Thanksgiving, and I wanted to give you thanks for everything you do. You know, words, a lot of times they don't work. This is a group that has been consistent and amazing, and we really, really want to thank you and say, please, stay connected.
Oh,
it's time to thank you. So give yourselves a hand.
I need a DYCD bomber jacket though. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Which is
thank you.
I said thank you.
I know. I also want to thank the staff that puts these meetings together so that we can get them again.
And then it's okay with you. I think that the person in the room, there's a lot of special people in the room, but I want to give special thanks to Greg Hamburg for his undying
commitment.
And this is for you. She's gonna get it. Ah, that's Jackie! Oh, yeah.
That's leather.
No, mine is leather.
You have a
leather. This is a fleece. I'm getting a leather.
Oh, no,
they're ornaments.
Harvard. He's a nice little lawyer. Very nice. But he does it, he's beautiful.
Great round of applause. So you ready? Okay. Take it away, Joe. Any questions, by the way?
Yeah, well, actually, one question.
One question.
Can I, just one quick question. In terms of the recent political events, are you seeing a lot of changes with the HRA, the immigration?
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if
has it affected?
If the numbers are very high or what you're hearing. Because in the Bronx, we're having a lot of events for people to register, and the numbers are very, very high. And I know there's a grant with HRA to do immigration, right?
Are you talking about our immigration program?
Talking about Trump's seating.
Well, but your program you have a small
to help with
HRA, right?
Oh yeah, those programs were underway already, so we've not seen any impact on that. We've not actually seen any impact
not
on anything
yet.
Right yet. We won't
yet.
See
so
it.
So you're not hearing
we
any.
We'll see it.
I hear what you're saying.
Right, but if the numbers were to increase, there's really nothing that you can do, I guess, because the amounts of money are all fixed already, right?
Exactly.
Oh, okay. But there are
you know that we're working on 17, so.
But there are the immigration.
Right, no, I was just curious.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's a good question.
Yeah,
we don't know. That's why people have to speak, be active, stay involved.
Yeah.
I believe, Jared Williams, did you have a question? Oh, did you have a question?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I couldn't imagine.
I'm going to pick up where Sandy left off about the community assessment. So as you said, we're doing a different sort of
community. Joe, you've got to talk
to the mic. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can.
In my head, it's like very loud. So I was just going to pick up where Sandy left off about the community needs assessment. And the way we're doing it this year is different than the way we've done it in the past. And again, in line with what we're saying with the community, with the strategic plan in terms of a deeper community engagement and a deeper level of data collection, we're doing a different sort of community needs assessment that we've done in the past. Previously, we did it was basically two things. We had a one-page survey, and then we had public hearings. And last time around, and the survey was done by the neighborhood advisory boards on the street, and they also hosted the public hearings. We had about 8,600 or so, a little more than that, surveys that were collected during the street surveys and then also at the public hearings. And then we had like 66 public hearings and 1,200 people, I think, came, 300 people spoke, that sort of thing. So we're still doing the hearings, and we're in the middle of doing them, and you have, when you walked in, the listing as they are right now of the public hearings. As we get more, we will continue to put them on our website, and I just want you to see from the website that you can go to the USD, nyc.gov/DYCB, and if you scroll over here, this thing scrolls on its own, but if you're lucky, you'll see this page eventually. And if you click into it, it'll give you the listing of the hearings, and then if you actually just scroll down to the bottom, there's the listing.
Okay.
And then the ones that are still to be held are in orange, and if you click right on it, you could actually sign up to register to go to the hearing.
That's
pretty cool. We did not do that before. That's
very nice.
Yeah. So on top of that, though, we're doing different kinds of surveys. So, we spoke with you previously about the customer service survey, right? We'll do that in detail. That's part of it, the assessment. Also, this time around, with the state, we've expanded the kinds of places we've gone to for information. So we've gone to employers, managed commuters, employers, to see what they feel about the needs of communities in terms of issues around poverty. We have an interfaith survey that we're working on for leaders of congregations in houses of worship, and a partner in Queensboro President's Office to help us get some more. And the mayor's office helped us get some interfaith, and Queensboro President's Office is trying to help us get some more interfaith as well. We did a principal survey for the principals at school. Mm-hmm. We have the directors of the programs. We did a survey with them. We've done a youth survey where it's just geared to what youth the old buildings are in New York City. We have over 2,500 of those so far. And
wow, that's pretty good.
That's everybody. And then we have the big one again, which is the adult survey. The difference about the adult survey this year is that instead of it being a one-page survey, there is a list of what we fund. Just check off what's the important part to you. This is a six-page survey that's very deep. It goes to what we need to find out for purposes of our own knowledge in terms of how we're going to conduct our programs around issues of poverty. It also goes to what the state is looking for us to collect, and the federal government is looking for us to collect in terms of demographics and who gets served, what kind of people are getting served, more detailed information about what the needs are. So this year, the survey instrument is actually 6 pages long, which has been a real challenge for our board members to get somebody to sit through 6 pages. But last time I said we got about 8,600. This time we are close to 7,800, almost 8,000, okay, and all said and done, which is very similar in number to what we did last time. However, last time we had one page survey, one page worth of data, which wasn't very rich. So we had 8,600 plus sheets of data that we then scoured, right, and analyzed. This time we have 46,800 pages of data.
Oh my God.
Yes. I'll say that over again because it's too far. 46,800 pages of data because we have such a deep and rich
survey.
So the community needs assessment will be, all the information is going to be analyzed and it's going to be put into a booklet kind of form of some sort, which will then be presented back to you as a board.
Wow.
At the April meeting, and then you will then have time to approve it, look it over, discuss it, and then you'll actually approve it. If we have preliminary, we already just part of it would be when we went over the customer service. If we have anything preliminary at the January meeting, we'll cover that with you in the January meeting, and then when we don't, then we'll have it at the April meeting, and we'll do that again. That's it. So, any questions?
Who's going to do the input of the data?
Oh, last time, it was like a military operation where we had to like give everybody sheets of paper and they sat there in front of, I was going to say a typewriter, but it's me, in front of the keyboard. But this time, they actually were getting scanned.
Oh, good. Okay.
Zip.
That's good. That's easy.
Yeah, we're welcome to 2000 for us. So anyway, any other questions? All right, thanks.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you for the commissioner's report. There aren't any other questions. I'll entertain a motion now to accept the commissioner's report.
So moved.
Just say your name, please.
Marilyn Mosley.
Been moved.
Second. Bernice Williams.
Properly second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Abstaining, there will be a none. So moved. Thank you for that. So next up will be our committee reports. We're going to start off with the governance report. I'm going to defer to Joe a little bit for some of the details of the last governance committee meeting, but we do need to vote in a new third vice chair overseeing the strategic partnerships committee that has now been vacated by Karen Eason. There originally were two members on the slate, Joe Gagliato and Vera Williams. Joe has since removed his name from the slate. Joe's father-in-law passed away. And he sent me an email today. He also sent an email to BYCD. So obviously he has to deal with that. And my thoughts and prayers with his family. So as a result, he has removed his name from the slate. So right now, the one name on the slate is Barry Williams. And this is now an opportunity, if anyone on the CAB is interested to submit their name as a candidate, now is the time to do so. Anyone at all is interested in third vice chair. It's a good question. So it's overseeing the strategic partnership as part of the executive committee. So a lot of the partnerships with the programs that are talked about, you know, BYCD, the Fatherhood Initiative, the Beacon programs, and things of those natures, this committee works directly with the process of vetting those programs and partnering with UICD make sure, as a CAB, we're aware of all those various programs that take place in the five boroughs. It's a broad overview, but Joe, if there's a further explanation you want to give, that'd be fine.
And then in terms of just partnering, finding ways, new ways to partner with the community in terms of community outreach, finding other partners in the community, and then helping us do recruitment around NAB issues.
You'd also be attending the executive board committee meeting, as well as sharing your own strategic partnership meeting.
And for those who have been, this mic is killing me. For those who have been on the CAB for a while, you might remember that this was previously called the Participation Committee.
Right.
And we purposely switched this to the strategic partnerships to really tie in with
the new vision of UICD and how we, as a board, should be partnering with all of these programs in the five boroughs. And, you know, a lot of the success of that is what you've seen in terms of presentations, in terms of successive programs and so forth. So this is kind of the new direction we've been going into for the last year. So hopefully that answered your question.
Okay, I also read in the email that it's only until...
Can you speak up and say your name?
I read it not. My name is Jacqueline Bailey, and I read in the email that it's only till April 2017. It's a partial.
Yeah,
so it's a partial because of the length of the specific term.
Right.
All right, so the term follows the position and not so much the person that was in the position.
They're finishing.
So you'll be finishing, or whoever's in that position will be finishing that term, and then, you know, go back in at the next voting for the position.
I usually attend the meetings, and for some reason, strategic planning is pulling me towards it. Well, let me sit here and think about it.
Okay, we'll give you 30 seconds.
We're doing it now.
Think about it.
We're doing it right
yes.
now.
Yes.
Right now.
Oh.
Yeah. And you know we have one.
I'll try it. All right. She's going.
So we're going to have to pass out slips. So we have two people on the slate. Everyone knows Vera Williams. Vera Williams, just raise your hand. She's the other CAB member that is putting her name down on the slate.
And
there's
been on the board. Right?
And I apologize for the issue with the mic. We're going to have to pass it around because literally it's only one mic. Right. Literally, only one mic working. But Vera, do you want to say a few words? As I want to pass the mic to you, and obviously you say a few words as a candidate.
Good evening, everyone. I really hadn't planned to say anything, but I've been just advised to tell you that I've been involved for many years in ABCAB. And I decided that I'd like to see what this position is all about and how we are going to improve and bring in new innovative ideas that interest me. Thank you.
And then just want to pass, are you officially putting your name on the stage?
No.
Okay, so if you want to say a few words as well.
Huh?
And just state your name for it.
Okay. My name is Jacqueline Bailey, and I'm an
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. My name is Jacqueline Bailey, and I've been on the NAB for maybe a year, and as the chairperson, but I've been involved in my community for over 30-some years, so this is very enlightening to me. It's allowing me to direct people in the right areas to where the services that they're needed can be provided. So I'm interested in it. It's a part of my graduate school studies also. Thank you. Have a good evening. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
just regular money.
Okay, so thank you for that. So does everyone, first off, I just want to just repeat just to make sure, is there any other CAB member that wishes to put their name as part of the slate for this position?
I'm moving to approve.
Second. Okay, so Marilyn Mosley moved to close the slate, probably seconded by Gloria Benfield. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? There being none, so moved. So does everyone have a slip of paper?
Yes.
Okay, so please write the name of the person you wrote. Names are Gloria Williams and Jacqueline Bailey. You vote for either Gloria Williams or Jacqueline Bailey. Not both.
Can you spell Jacqueline's name?
Is it Jacqueline, is it J-A-C-Q-U-E-L-I-N-E?
Yep.
Bailey.
And Vera is V-E-R-A?
Correct. And Anita and Joe will be
saying the ballots.
Is that E-D-W-I-N-A? Thank you.
Oh yeah, you saw it. That is it. Because he was on five. My first one, I thought. Yes. I knew it was him.
Yeah.
It was. Willie Morgan. Yes,
so while the votes being tallied, I'm going to ask Joe to just kind of run through the rest of the governance committee and so forth real quick.
Okay, so we talked in the governance committee, we had conversations about the vacancies. So we still have, after tonight, we still have only two vacancies left. The two regions, there's an absentee report, and we had some conversation about folks who were getting up there in terms of absenteeism, and we focused actually on two organizations, which we contacted and informed them, and they both responded and appointed new people, and so we have pretty stuff going on with those two, so that hopefully you solve that problem. We reported about the fact that the representatives or alternates are the terms that are acceptable by the state for the reps on the board. We explained about the conflict of interest stuff, how we do it. It's really important that we have to have all the conflict of interest forms. Anybody who shows up to a meeting as an official member, that includes all the private organizations and elected officials. And then we're going to work with the reps of the elected officials because we need something in the file from the actual elected official person itself. So we're just closer to the point where we can get something rough to work it out. And then we had a long conversation about the use of excused absences for quorum and whether or not they should be allowed. And then there was a conversation about what would be acceptable quorum. And there's some back and forth on that.
Is that mic?
And I know we're talking to our attorney about that from the agency, about what's been the appropriate forum, and then the board will then talk about it again in the January meeting, which is something that the state had pointed out to us when we did our last across the issue of excuse absences for forums. Then there's another issue about how we handle people who are on the board and getting appointed to the DYCB, which was then just sort of a conversation at the table. And that's it.
Okay, any questions on the governance committee meeting? And for the purposes of the new members, a lot of the recap of the committee meetings is in your packet as well, so you can kind of follow through. We just do kind of a top level recap, but if you want anything in detail, it's in your packet.
I do have something to say about governance. So just so you guys know, Karen Eason's appointment or hiring to DYCD was done, because she was on the list originally, she applied,
yeah, she
right, she explained all of that. But I did have a point of reference, and it is in your minutes, that will be discussed at the next governance meeting, for the simple fact that I felt really strongly around the fact that I felt like it was a conflict of interest. I'm pushing really hard to fill these vacancies on our board here, and to apply to DYCD, it should just be a point of, you know, just, my brain is not working today, I'm sorry. It should just be a matter of transparency, where board members let us know that, hey, I'm on the slate, you know, for hiring, or I'm interested in working for DYCD, and so I'm going to step down, etc. So we'll be discussing that at governance to facilitate that process. We're not saying we don't, you know, that people shouldn't get hired by DYCD. It's a great place to work.
Yeah, but they may not be called.
But we just want to make, they may not be called, but it's a matter of transparency. Just let us know. Because then otherwise it looks like, oh, DYCD is doing us a favor because we serve on the board and I'm applying. What if I'm looking for work and I want to work here? But that's a conversation that governance. So it's just a matter of transparency. We just want to weed that out, and just so that everybody, you know, everything is above board and everybody is happy. That's it.
What's her title?
Community Program Manager.
Program Manager.
Program Manager.
And that's Ladders, the Ladders program? Leaders for the Ladders?
And just to reiterate, not implying anything was done wrong. These type of things, you know, come up once every so often, and when they do, we just got to find a way to just address it, just so that we're dotting the I's, crossing the T's, and the transparency is there. So it's just something that's going to be the point of discussion at the next governance meeting, in absence of our chair here. So congratulations to our new third vice chair, Ms. Jacqueline Bailey.
So you're responsible for taking us all out to lunch?
Okay.
Okay, great.
All right. Well, on a serious note, I mean, you know, congratulations. You seem to be tied into some of the visions of the committee, so official the next full board meeting. You'll be sitting as part of the executive committee, so we'll talk about how that process will work. And obviously at the next strategic partnership meeting, you will be chairing that meeting as well, and we'll give you the dates up front, so at least you have an idea how to fit that into your schedule. And whatever we need to do as a CAB and as an executive board to support you, look forward to doing that. All right, congratulations. All right, so next up is program committee report. Pass it over to Melissa.
So that's me. But two things. One, I wasn't there. Vera is not here. I'm sorry, Tessa is not here, and she shared it. And my contacts, I can't see. So I can't even read the minutes, so I want to apologize for that. Can you read it for me?
I'm sorry, read what?
The program committee minutes. So this is the group that presented.
All right, so there was a presentation by the Home Crest Community Service. Karen Zura, I think that's her name, kind of gave an overwork that's being done. Home Crest Community Service is a senior center, so she discussed the different activities that are taking place throughout the year at that particular senior center, and Karen talked about some of the experiences of the participants as a result of that senior center. New business, which I'm aware of. Mike Bobbitt updated the committee that Rosanna Rosado was appointed as the new Secretary of State for the New York State Department. And it was also mentioned that DYCD will be hosting Brownsville and Brownsville, Brooklyn, Connecting the Dots, convening in the Van Dyke Cornerstone. And at that time, it took place at October 22nd, but that's already passed. And that's it. Thank you. So let me go back a little bit, because I don't think I properly did this. Shift it back to the governance committee report. We didn't vote to accept the governance committee report. So I need a motion to accept the governance committee report.
So moved.
I'm sorry.
Second.
Okay, yeah, a lot of people do that. Okay, let me catch up. Marilyn Mosley, properly motioned. Just Jacqueline state your name.
Jacqueline Bailey.
Second by Jacqueline Bailey. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, abstained, there being none, so moved. Now shifting to the program committee report. I'd like to entertain a motion to accept that.
So moved.
They're properly moved by Gloria Benfield.
Second
by Melissa. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, abstaining, there being none, so moved. Strategic partnership recap. Obviously focused on replacing the third vice chair, which we already took care of. Joe talked about some of the vacancies that took place. Am I reading the right report? Okay, so these are the notes. Okay. Don't have it. So scratch that. We don't have a report for strategic partnership. So one thing that we talked about, Joe already stated, which was the vacancies for the various areas. So my apologies. No strategic partnership update, but we will have an update for you at our next meeting. Okay, so next up, so we're gonna ask, so this took place a few meetings ago. Obviously, as dictated by the state, there has to be a presentation to the CAB on the annual reporting of CSB funding and programs. And Mike Bobbitt has always done a great job of this. Him and his team and all of ACD is really ingrained in this. And the last time the report was done, you know, it's a pretty robust report. It's a pretty heavy and robust report and a lot to digest in a meeting of this sort. So what I asked like Mike to do, really, and especially for the new members, kind of go through this. As per the state, he has to do it. And this is part of what we want to know in terms of the success of the programs. But to kind of, as best as possible, do just some top-level recap of this report, and then we'll email it out to you. If we were to go through this entire report, and you'd be here all night, and you'll be lost after about 15 minutes.
Mike is very thorough.
So if Mike could just really go through some of the top level feedback from the report, just so we have an understanding, and certainly if there's anything specific, the report is going to be available to the entire board. Going to do the abbreviated version, but Joe just reminded me that the detail is in your packet right now, so you can take that to review at some point.
Thank you, Chair. Good evening, CAB.
Good evening.
So again, this presentation is in keeping with what we did last year, where we're able to summarize the year's work and the messages received give me information, but as you said, try and condense the information. So you have the detail in your, So you have the detail in your packets, and we're not going to pour over the detail now, but you have it. So in the space between now and the next meeting, if there are additional questions, you can email Joe's team. So but for the purposes of right now, the PowerPoint that we've provided should help summarize kind of the year in review. So one important thing that I've pointed to a few times over the year, and by the way, I want to take this moment to acknowledge Becky Parsons. She is from the New York State Department of State. She's observing our meeting this evening. She actually was here a year ago this time, so she's seen that presentation, and later on, I expect we'll get some feedback as to how today's presentation goes. But important for this group to understand, the city fiscal year starts on July 1st and ends June 30th. And so when we contract with community-based organizations to provide services, That's the term of our contract here with them. The federal fiscal year starts on October 1st and runs through September 30th. So in past years, when we've tried to summarize our work, we've had to straddle two city fiscal years whenever we explain to the state what we've done over the year. So I want to acknowledge Becky and her team. After years of looking at these historic reports, they've understood it's a lot more elegant and a lot more straightforward if we can report in accordance with the city fiscal year. And so that will actually make this report and the information that you review much more straightforward. As you'll see, starting July 1st, ending June 30th, we had certain expectations of every provider, every portfolio. And at the end of the year, we can see how they did, and it will make sense to us. So we're able to report basically how programs operate. So that is a huge time saver, and it actually makes it hugely much more straightforward. So we're loving that. So that's like a highlight, like that's a big deal. Yes? Well, no, they're not. So each year, oh, you're right, it is. That's a typo. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so it's wrong in your slides. Let's pretend it was a six all along. Thank you. Good catch. All right, so let's pretend it was zero all along. Okay, so that should say October 1st of 2015 to September 2016. So anyway, what we're going to be discussing is along the city fiscal year. So there are several reasons why we want to do this presentation, and in the Deputy Commissioner's presentation earlier, she mentioned one of the national organizational standards, but I want to briefly reference three. There are several reasons why we present this information. Again, under the organizational standard 4.4, you receive an annual update on the success of specific strategies, including the Community Action Plan. So Sandy talked about the strategic plan. The detail you have is what the state calls the work plan. And so they like to know that we understand and share with the CAB there's a relationship between the annual work plan, what we do every year, and a strategic vision for why we're doing what we're doing. So this presentation allows us to share that information with you and show the connection with you. The second standard we can achieve by tonight is 6.5. The CAB has received updates on progress meeting the goals of the strategic plan or comparable planning document within the past 12 months. So I want to make a connection. Some of you on the board, certainly the executive committee, have seen the 2012 management plan. The 2012 management plan for DYCD has been updated by the 2016 strategic plan that's been approved by the board. The work that the agency already has underway, what we've contracted for over the past few years, is the outcomes related to the management plan. And when we complete the community needs assessment, which Joe has presented on, that will inform future work, future contracts, and future work plans. So I just want to make sure we set that context and make sure the CAB board members, you're mindful. The work that we're doing now is resultant from the last community needs assessment. And we are appropriately carrying out, the CBs are appropriately doing what we have funded them to do. When we complete the next one, then that will inform the work that we will then do. And then this same process will be related to the new strategic plan and the new work. So right now we're setting context. This relates to 2012. And we'll pivot shortly. The third standard I wanted to reference is 9.3, which is that the CA that we have presented to the CAB for review and action within the past 12 months, an analysis of the agency's outcomes and any operational strategic program adjustments and improvements identified as necessary. So when we look at our results, I'll also be sharing with you whether things went according to plan. If they didn't go according to plan, what we intend to do about it, what we're having the CBOs do about it, that's an important function for this meeting. So you know, we course correct as we go. Many of the board members and AD members were in the Roma training. That's consistent with results-oriented management and accountability. You plan, you intend, you monitor, you oversee, you look and see what you've got, and if you need to make changes, you make changes. So I want to thank my colleagues, and I hope we left the room, but one of the things we wanted to do is try to visualize at a glance what was behind the numbers. So we don't want you to become awash in numbers. You have all the detail in your packet. But what's great about this visualization, I want to acknowledge Buck for helping us pull the numbers in such a way that we can really, in an economy of time, see not only how we did, but see very quickly that we did well. So I can walk over here and you can see. For each program portfolio, all the contracts that fall under, let's say, high school, for instance, or what's here is also the new opportunity youth contract. On this slide, we also have, as artists presented earlier, the Summer Youth Employment Program, the CSBG's funded slots for that, and the Fatherhood Initiative. So these are some programs that target, in whole or in part, adolescents. The first column are the projected enrollment numbers for those programs, and then immediately to the right, the actual enrollment. So we'll just pause there for a second. So you see, how many people did we say we would serve for high school, for opportunity youth, for SYP, for others, okay? So right away, we know we did well. So this, again, you wanted a high level, yeah. The detail is there, you can see the numbers, right? Yeah. But the graphs show what we did, what we're supposed to do. So yeah. Then we look at outcomes, right? High school programs take students who may be struggling in a subject matter at a GPA level and help promote academic improvement, right? Mm-hmm. Did they do what they're supposed to do? Opportunity youth programs take disconnected adolescents, help them devise career plans, get their resume together, get the support of employment, and try to hand them off to employment, vocation, etc. Did they do what they were supposed to do? SYP reliably does what it's supposed to do. The Fatherhood Initiative, which by and large has done well, historically has had some retention challenges, particularly with the adolescents in the initiative, but we saw the enrollment numbers just a little bit under what we expected. In terms of the outcomes, some of the dads increased both their material and financial contribution to their children and their emotional engagement, reliability, availability of their children.
Wonderful.
It did what it was supposed to do. So I can move on.
Very good.
Here we have our program portfolio that relates to immigrant services. So I'm going to walk across again. The immigrant families portfolio, and I'm going to remind the CAB, we presented on this last year, and one of the things we did, which was consistent with that standard, we talked about a problem. We had had some challenges related to outcomes a couple of years ago, and one of the things we said that was consistent with Roma is when you experience challenges, there's an array of strategies as far as how you want to fix the problem. Sometimes you abandon something because it's not working. Sometimes you double down. And that's what we did. Some of you may remember we added more money to these programs to add more ESOL and other services for the parents. So these programs right now have youth outcomes, try to keep the kids from being pulled out of school by the parents, try to keep the kids in school, and supportive elements for the parents, right? So now under this new model, there are the enrollment figures, those are their outcome figures. The program did what it was supposed to do. These next bars relate to the immigrant legal services programs, which are now overseen by HRA. So they're like our super sub-recipient. And these programs fall under the rubric of larger legal services that HRA is providing. Still CSBG programs. Over this year, they still have the same program design as when we transfer them over from DYCD. And so just very quickly, you can see immigrant legal assistance actually over-enrolled and made its outcome. Services for immigrant legal youth slightly over-enrolled and exceeded its outcomes. Immigrant DV services slightly over-enrolled and met its outcomes. Services for immigrant workers slightly over-enrolled and came pretty close to its targets for outcomes. So we're pleased to see that, be able to report that. Under NDA, we have several options, one's here and then the rest will get to the next slide. Met its enrollment targets, and then in terms of helping immigrant participants attain legal status and benefits, met its outcomes. So I can move on again. I'm gonna do this and I'll come back to that slide. So we were talking about NDA. So again, these are neighborhood-based programs, and each NDA defines the programs that they need. So we're thinking citywide, knowing that each individual NDA will have different programs. The seniors programs met their enrollment targets, and there are two kinds of outcomes. Some seniors programs focus on social, emotional, and cultural well-being, while others focus on access service, like a healthy families program that targets seniors who need to access benefits and services, right? On both fronts, they met or slightly exceeded their outcomes. Housing programs have struggled lately since we changed the model under this RFP. We were allowing housing programs previously to enroll participants for like service rent exemptions, like SCRE entry, like basically just filing applications, which didn't necessarily mean that those persons were in immediate housing risk. They were just helping them file benefits and services, right? So when we changed our program model, it became a little bit more challenging for some of the housing providers to really reshift their focus and find appropriate clients to provide needed services, right? So it's a little bit of a challenge with enrollment and recruitment, and our staff works rigorously with those providers to try to assist them in identifying clients. There's a lot of capacity building training that they receive. But even with that, we've come pretty close to their outcome targets, right? So they're actually being very effective with the participants they serve. The Healthy Families Program met its enrollment targets, met its outcome targets. Literacy, which is why I picked this one, and then I'll circle back, met its enrollment targets. And we had some variability here, which can shift from year to year, because adult literacy programs can do ABE, basic education, or they could do high school equivalency, right? So they had the number of persons they expected, but they had fewer than they expected ABE and more than they expected HSE. And that variability can happen from year to year. So we observed that, and again, not everything is necessarily a problem. So as the Department of State knows, they asked us next year, you're gonna change your projections? No, based on historic trends, we think it will go back to what it was. Hmm. These are also the other literacy programs I don't wanna miss. Adolescent literacy met its enrollment targets, met its outcome targets. And then again, ESOL actually slightly exceeded its enrollment targets, met its outcome targets. So I can move on. Capacity building. So just very quickly, when you really pour through the work plan, you see that we even account for our capacity building unit and the CSBG dollars spent for the family development credential, right? So they met their, I think there's a bar missing. All right, I have to circle back to you on that one. You have to look at the detail of that one, right? But I can tell you, they've actually, let me see.
This is better.
Okay. So if you were to double it now, but if you were to look at the detail, for FDC, we projected to serve 150 participants, and we served 177, which is 180% of the goal. And in terms of the completers, all that's what's there, the outcome. So we were supposed to serve 117, we served 120, so that's 103%. Of the goal. So we basically did what we were supposed to do. Capacity building broadly, you know, a lot of people come into this agency, a lot of the staff at CBS come in for training, right? So we projected we would serve about 1,700 people in that way, and we actually served 1,600. And we also track how many people come in for customized assistance, sometimes on site. Maybe they're looking for different kind of restructuring or board organization within their CBO. So we projected we serve about 45 agencies that way, and indeed 38 agencies after that kind of assistance we provided, so we met that target as well. Next year, we'll do this in a slightly easier way. Some of these things, as you do it, you see what you get. We've actually been talking to the Department of State about the information that we've arrayed. So why does all this look the same? This is actually a reporting thing. So we said 499 members of the staff will be trained in various kinds of required training that they need to know, like right to know and EEO kind of stuff, right? So, I mean, it's mandatory training. We made our target. So it's not a surprise we made our target. We just realized when I present this to you next year, we'll probably be able to say, you know, the required training, and it'll just be one graph rather than multiple graphs of the same, basically the same stuff. So then we also have elective training. And so this is a nice thing to tell about the agency. We projected that of that 499 staff, maybe about half of the folks would volunteer extra capacity to sign up for training that they don't need to take. But we actually had multiple people sign up for multiple training. So we're actually looking at this number and seeing whether this is a duplicated number, because we don't actually have 682 people on staff. So we have to think about how we want to report that number differently. But what I can let you know is we certainly exceeded our projections. So we can say something nice about the staff. The staff wants to grow, they want to be developed, right? I'm going to make one change when we next make this report. We're asked in the broader spirit of partnership to enumerate how many partnerships we'll have under community action, right? So if you look at all of the delegate agency contracts we have, this is a number. And if you back out the ones that we know are institutions of post-secondary learning, like CUNY, anything we find CUNY, we have 6 of those. Now, when we used to report this, we thought we had about 22 of these. Because if you just look on the face of it, maybe we find an organization with a name like Catholic Charities, or a name like Jewish Council of, you know, and is, but you shouldn't make presumptions. So when we ask the CBOs, do they self-classify as faith-based organizations? No, we classify as 501c3s.
Oh.
And so we change the designation based on the feedback we got. And so we've been in dialogue with the Department of State, like, do you really want to have a projection of 0? So this is just a report. Like, we didn't think after we made the change we'd have 0. We had 22, we revised it down, and we had what we thought we would have. We had what we thought we would have. This number only went down because a few contracts were reassigned. So maybe an agency we're already funding said, oh, if they're not going to do that contract, I'm going to do that contract. Hmm. So we understand why that happens. Now, you'll appreciate this, because, for instance, our board chair and other members of the CAB, because they're different stakeholders in the community, we actually enumerate those. So we thought we would have one partnership with a for-profit business that happens to be Models, and we have one. And if you look down here, whoever you are in the group, you know, Health First is listed, the various consortiums are listed, and now that we know the state wants us to report that information, we share the breadth of who's on the board.
Oh.
And that's it.
Is that new?
Is it new? Relatively new. We presented on it last year, but again, we had so much information we presented on that we may not have spent as much airtime on the capacity building, the agency stuff, and the partnership stuff. So if you're able to do this highlight stuff, you can kind of see quicker glimpse. This is it. And this is really the summary of all that we've done. You know, I mean, my one editorial would be, I think, that we had a good year.
Good.
We anticipate having a good year again.
I like that.
Right. Are there questions?
As always, head spinning. I love your presentation.
but I love that format. It's not complicated. I love it.
Well, I thank both Deputy Commissioner Gutierrez and Booker. You saw him on the way in, so we'll continue to use a format like this to make it straightforward.
Here, Marilyn.
Oh, sorry.
How effective was the agency as it relates to poverty?
Yes. In general, it was quite effective. So out of a projected 1,200 dads served, we served 1,091. And in terms of combined outcomes, dads who improved both their financial engagement and emotional engagement, out of a projected 430 dads, we had 486 dads report that growth. So we think that we had a good year. We anticipate this year will be a good year, and I think as was presented in the last meeting, there'll be new RFPs, both for immigrant families and for fatherhood. So we think under the new model, we'll continue to have robust
that
results.
Citywide?
Yep, that's across the 10 providers who have contracted to provide those services.
Do we do a percentage in predicting from the projected enrollment to the projected outcomes? Is there a percentage why it's the projected outcomes seems to be so lower?
That's a great question. So what's the simple answer? The logic for any program would follow some theory of change or some logic model, right? So if you let's stick with this for a minute. If you think 1,200 people are going to get enrolled, then one, what we do, and when we revise these reports with the Department of State, we look back to the historical performance.
Okay.
So every provider has a contract, and if they say, I'm going to serve 100, we had 10 contracts, so we're going to serve 120 dads, and then they say 50% of them are going to make the outcome, something like that.
Okay.
40% are going to make the outcome. Mm-hmm. So we know what we're holding the agencies accountable to, but then we also know what the overall trends are.
Okay.
And actually, we should be thankful that the Department of State understands that, because sometimes you have CBOs who, when they try to get the contract, they said, oh, and 95% of the people are going to have everything wonderful happen as a result. That is infeasible.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yes,
that cannot happen. So we have to have some reasonable flexibility. So we look at what happened, like we do. We look at what happened last year, so then we can project for next year when we're doing the same things. Once in a while, if you change a program, you have to revise your expectations because you've made a change.
Yes,
you know?
Absolutely.
Now, just one quick thing. If you look, not now, when you look at the spreadsheet, you'll see the percentages are there. So we have a projected number,
okay,
the actual number, and then the last column is the percentage. And what the state has us do is, and I've mentioned this before, if there's a variance, if we do less than 80% or more than 120% of something, then they want to know why. When it's more than 120%, they want to know why it's so great. They want to know that we know why it's so great, right? You know, and what we're going to do about it if it's
okay.
So there are percent, but to keep this clean, we went with the bars and the numbers, and you can always pull because you can see the percentages on that template.
Got it.
Any other questions? So, for those who were here, the last person, oh, there is one, I'm sorry. Just state your name, please.
Edwina Martin. I was just wondering if we'll be receiving this electronically, because it's a lot of information to digest.
I thought the printout was in the...
The
PowerPoint is?
Yeah, not the graph.
Oh, really?
Right.
Oh,
PowerPoint.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Yes.
We'll send it to you.
Yeah, we'll send it to you. Yeah, we can make it. We'll do it as a PDF, so it's a smaller file. Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, this is much easier. Last time, what's in your handout was the presentation.
Up on the
screen. Yeah. It was a little tough to digest. This is much easier.
Again, please.
I like that. And I like the colors.
They did grab it. So I realize now that there are some. Are these in the front? I don't know what you're
doing.
So we're going to check. We may have, just to answer your question, we may actually have the handout. I think they have the handout at the front desk. Okay. That's always easier for me. So either we'll give it to you as a handout or we'll send it to you electronically.
Oh, you actually have that outside?
Yes.
You have it, you have it.
Very nice. Thank you, Bob. Oh, I'm sorry. Did you, Jacqueline, have one more question?
Huh?
Yeah, Jacqueline, I may need to give you a line.
Jacqueline, do you go from the last year's number of how many participants you had, or forecast for the upcoming year? Yes, well, again, we look at the contracts, and we look at last year's performance in terms of the projected and the actual numbers. Yeah. And then, if you use an example like immigrant families, we added funding to that portfolio, so then that was an opportunity where we had to think about whether we thought that would change the projections. And you thought it would in terms of they were underperforming, so when we added that, we thought it would bring it in line with where we wanted it to be, and it was.
I just have one more question.
Sure.
And this is not to say anything about the agents, but I just like to know. Has there ever been a time when you didn't make the target?
Sure.
I'm sure.
Has it been often or not?
Sure.
I will restate the example that I gave last year when I did this report. Immigrant families had not made the outcome projection. And so, like the various functions that show we're meeting the organizational standards, we had a conversation with the board about what we intended to do about that. Or another example, now this year I said the housing programs, the enrollment is a little bit below our projections. And so I will restate what we were doing about that. We've been providing technical assistance, both my team, it's part of an NDA, so my team oversees that, as well as we fund some of the capacity building. So we've sent some of those providers, actually I didn't say at this level of detail. So there's a lot of outreach and recruitment training that DYC makes available to providers. So over the past year, we've made a point of working with capacity building to make sure they do targeted training about engaging and retaining adults.
Mm.
You know, a very different skill set than getting kids to stay engaged in after school, because adults don't need to walk into the program whatsoever, right? So when we have these programs, how do they appeal? It's a different skill set. You may be very skilled when someone comes in to help them, but how do you find that next person? So we have invested in trying to help them meet the goal. And again, when we're here again next year, I'll be able to report on whether the things we've tried so far have produced a result.
Are we penalized at all for not reaching our goals?
The short answer to that is no. I think another community action agency, if they didn't do a good job demonstrating their analysis, maybe they would be penalized.
They would be penalized.
You know, but
okay.
We have, as you see, and when you go to the program committee meetings, you see we have an array of things in place. We do provider meetings. We make other linkage partners available. We closely monitor what the programs are doing, coach on what the programs are doing. Every quarter we report in the state on how things are going. So they're aware of the monitoring that we do,
that's
and the strength-based supervision we provide.
Thank you, Mike. Appreciate it. User-friendly presentation. We like that.
We love it, right?
Okay, so I'm just going to go back real quick. I know we've been here a while. David Alexander here? David Alexander? Okay. And then we have Linda Walters? Yes. Okay. So these are the two new members to the CAB. First, David is representing CAB Region 13, Brooklyn NAB 11 and 12. And then we have Linda Walters, CAB Region 19, representing Staten Island, Region 1. So we welcome you both as new members to the CAB. We're ending our meeting now, but I wouldn't want to rob you of the opportunity to say a few words if you want to. So first, Linda, if you want a few words to the CAB.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. As well, you know, my name is Linda Walters. I've worked 14 years with the New York City Housing Authority, so I'm familiar with a lot of the information that the gentleman had presented in terms of meeting goals and just dealing with the community. I'm here to help. I'm ready to learn. I'm ready to go. And if I can be of any service to anybody else, please let me know.
Hi, I'm David Alexander. I'm not sure if I got the community board set up a certain point. Or the 5 and 6
interviews. 5 and 6 and both.
What is it supposed to say that again?
5 and 16 in Brooklyn.
In Brooklyn.
Oh, so then, okay. We'll correct that on here. 5 and 16?
I was confused.
Okay.
Okay. I am very familiar with DY Seating. I appreciate the things that they do. I'm on the community board in New York, Ward 16. And I serve on the youth committee. And the services that you provide to our school, because I reach out to the school to make sure that they have services there that GYC offers. And I'm very encouraged by the things that you do. And I would like to keep the flow going to serve the city of the community, to the kids that need after-school programs to help them develop the educational skills that they need to become successful. And you guys do a good, guys and girls, you do a good job at meeting their needs. So I'd like to thank you, and if there's anything that I can do, please let me know.
Get us more members for the NAB.
That's
what we need.
Thank
you.
Thank you. So I'll entertain a motion now to accept both David Alexander and Linda Walters as new members to the CAB.
So moved.
Very properly moved. Gloria Benfield. And second by Vera Williams. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Abstain. There being none, so moved. Thank you. We look forward to working with you in the service. And for some of the new board members, you know, this year we did a lot of board training came out of the specifically the program committee. So after the holiday, after the first of the year, we will partner again with DYCD to really ramp up those trainings again. I think it'll be helpful for those who are new to the board. So we have the Roman training. They've all been heavily attended and well received. So look for that so at least you can, you know, find your way in terms of how productive you feel you could be on the board. Any old business?
This was a bit of advice. And the flyers are available.
So under new business, you'll see this flyer for the 2016 Immigration Resource Fair. It is taking place Sunday the 20th. That's this Sunday, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this Sunday the 20th, 12 to 4:30 at the Queens Library in Flushing. So just grab a flyer there. This was handed out by Susie. Raise your hand, Susie. Okay, great. Anything you want to add real quick on this that we should know, or it's pretty self-explanatory in the flyer?
On the flyer, we have 30 organizations that are going to be providing resources. We have 10 attorneys to help immigrants with immigration, housing, workers' rights problems. And the borough president would love for everyone, anyone who's in our borough on Sunday, especially given the election results.
Yes.
We want to come together and deliver a message of unity, solidarity, that we're going to continue to promote immigrant integration and celebrate cultural diversity. So we'd love for all of you to be here.
Great.
Thank you.
And next, this is another flyer. Lena, are these out somewhere?
Well, they came to our community board. The beautiful thing about this college access fair is they have people that will sit with the parents and actually do the FAFSA application. They will help them complete it, which is a very big deal.
All right, so this is on November, let me just tell them what it is, and then hopefully we'll pass this out. November 19th, which is when?
This is Saturday.
Yeah. So College Access Fair, this is taking place at Fordham University at the Rosio Bronx campus from 12:30 to 2:40. So they're going to have workshops here, they're going to talk about how to pay for college, they're going to, as she indicated, how to fill out the FAFSA, which if any of you had kids and done that, that's not a fun process. I've been there. But that's what you have to do if you want to get financial aid. They're going to talk about certain college preparation and even have a sessions specifically for the parents on how to handle the process. So,
how to pay for college.
November 19th, Fordham University, Bronx campus from 12:30 to 2:40. That's this Saturday. Okay. Any other new business? My new business I'm going to close with is business as usual for us. So, you know, there's a lot of talk, there's a lot of uncertainty. It's not a political statement. This is whatever we've been doing, let's just continue to do it. It's business as usual. We may need to have a stronger voice on some issues and on some programs, but when that time comes, we'll deal with that. But don't be discouraged. We've done a great job here. I want everyone to continue to do what they've been doing. I'll make sure I keep you on task, and I need you to keep me on task. Deal?
Yes.
Yes.
Deal.
So before we leave, also we went around the room and we said, oh, thank you everybody for all the great work that y'all are doing. Yes, thank you for all the great work y'all doing. Thank you to our stenographer lady, Miss Nicole. So I just want to give her a little bit of props too. Well, she works here. Molly works here.
So I do. I work here.
So we're gonna be giving you a little hat, Nicole, so you can take home and make your kids wear it. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? If not, have a great Thanksgiving, have a great holiday season. I look forward to seeing you. Entertain a motion to close the meeting. They're moved.
Second.
Probably second. So if they're moved by Gloria Benfield, second by Bernice Johnson. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Enjoy your holidays. Thank you.